Beep, 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 beep. Movie. Video. Oh, there's my cute little introduction. What's up, guys? Angels, demons, hell, yoga, and movies, possession, all that good stuff. What we'll be talking about today. And the first episode of the JB Salop YouTube channel. Just kidding, not the first one. But, you know, don't forget to like, subscribe, put the description down below. There's a link in there. Get 25% off your next rosary. Put my promo code in there, a JB Salop. Ha! No, just kidding. No. Do not try that. There will be no link there. Will be links in the description, though, for videos and books and online articles from which I have read or I think would be fruitful and meritorious for you guys. I'm going to try and keep this video relatively shorter because there's a whole lot that I could go into, but it may not be meritorious in the long run. Also, because I'd like to keep this relatively short time, not relatively, but we'll see. For your sake and for mine, spending time with family and friends is important since we are all home, but it is also important to turn our gaze and our hearts and our minds to the Lord and the things that involve Him therein, and things that try to take us away from Him, as is the topic of this video. I hope you guys have all safe travels home, all of your finals went well, that you are excited for this beautiful season that we are already in. Yesterday was Gaudete Sunday, meaning rejoice. Hopefully the priest was cool and wore rose-colored vestments and talked about the cool Laudate word. It is Latin. Hopefully they also lit the pink candle, because otherwise, I'm sorry, not based. Especially not based if you didn't go to Mass anyway. Anything else? Not that I can think of. I'm sure something will strike me. This is like my third time recording this. So if I haven't apologized, there might be a dog barking in the background. She's deaf, blind, can barely walk and barks at the wind. But I love Pebbles on this thing. Turns 15 today. Today is her birthday. December 13th. Anyways, I digress. I am all sugared up. I already had. Topic for another time. If you want a fantastic fruitcake, talk to me. So there's a hierarchy of God's creation. Of course, God does not exist in this hierarchy because He is not created. He simply exists. Neither does the Son or the Holy Spirit exist in this hierarchy of creation because they are begotten. Christ is begotten, and they exist outside of time and space, and were not created but have existed, always will exist, have always existed, always exist, and always will exist. So, but then between that is the angelic realm, which includes demons, and then the hierarchy of angels and things like that. I'll go into a little bit of depth on that. Then there are the humans, and then there, because we have the gift of intellect and free will, and then there are the, whatchamacallit, the animals and stuff like that. Things that, as Thomas Aquinas describes, do have some sort of soul, but they do not have free will, right? You have things like that. But that is the basic hierarchy of creation, of which we'll talk about that, mainly talking about that second realm, which is angels and demons. I'll spend a little time on angels, more on demons and stuff like that, because angels are really a little less talked about, thus I know less about them. And so I can get this first video out and get in a regular schedule. I did not do perhaps adequate research, but I know a little bit. And I did a little bit of research, mainly pertaining to that Thomas Aquinas. There are three levels he describes to angels. First is seraphim and the cherubim. Then are the thrones, and then the third level are the principalities and the lower level angels. I do believe that the archangels are in the first ranking that Thomas Aquinas describes them. They have either cherubim or seraphim. But we'll go back to what the angels are. They are beings initially created by God and are created by God, but they exist in a way that they can only know that God exists. They do not have the free will to know whether or not He exists. And this is where my knowledge is a little bit fuzzy. But to go, that is, the demons are fallen angels, includes Satan, who was Lucifer, led a revolt against God, and now exist still in the same angelic realm, and still have all the same powers that angels have subscribed to them by the divine power. But they do it, you know, they use the powers for evil, not good, to use a superhero reference. But Yes, angels, they exist in a hierarchy. The archangels, headed by Saint Michael, are the leaders of the heavenly hosts and the divine army. See Revelation, all sorts of good stuff. Gabriel's the messenger, all that good stuff. Raphael, he's cool too. Yes, Lucifer. Now, to my knowledge, there's not anything written about if there's a hierarchy of the demonic other than Satan. I assume that there is. It would somewhat be similar to that which is attributed to angels, because I believe that all different levels of angels fell. I believe that Lucifer, because Lucifer means light bearer, and so he was of the highest rank of angels. But I assume, because then there's reference to Legion and Beelzebub in sacred scripture. So I'm going to assume that there is some sort of level. If you've read C.S. Lewis's Screwtape Letters, while I was not a Catholic nor a theologian, I think that it also, I think it reflects a way in which could help make sense of the matter, and that there are angels that could tell other angels what to do because, for whatever reason, yada yada yada, they have subscribed more or less power. They have more or less power to do X or experience, but I'm not sure if that's how it works because, different. But there is a beautiful statement. I forget if it's where it is. I don't remember if it's in scripture. One of the fathers wrote it. But that the angels are actually jealous of us and our human existence because we can receive the Eucharist is essentially it. As if the angelic hosts are an automatically automatic presence of God and do not have to choose to love Him, but are automatically doing so. But those of us on earth have been given the gift to choose to know and to love God and to receive Him in a more beautiful way. And I'm sure those things are different on a metaphysical level in the way that they receive Him, because they have no need of salvation because they are angels. And I am sure that in the end times, and then for all eternity, there will be a different way, and perhaps wish they could partake of the sacrificial gift, while they would need no gift of sacrifice. I'm gonna say probably not. Do the angels need the Eucharist? I'm going to say no, because they have no need of salvation, because they are always in the divine light. Anyway, let's move on to demons. There are, because that's, whatever's interesting. I'm trying really hard to look at this camera, but I do like a little webcam, so it's something I know I'm looking at and I'm not distracted by me. There are, so first of all, let's establish the church position that there are people, priests, that will deny that exorcisms are necessary, that they are real, that people can be possessed, that there is obsession, infestation, oppression, all of which are taught by the church. Especially, you can ask many bishops, you can ask anybody who's ever seen or performed an exorcism by anybody, I mean priests. So let's break down those four terms really quick. We'll start with infestation. So for example, a demon can infest a house or an object or something. So yes, your coffee pot could technically be possessed, but more, infested is the proper word. I've also seen hexation used, but I don't know if that's a similar thing or if it's, vexation, regardless. Is yes, your house can be haunted, per se, by the demonic. So, yeah, if that's why I suggest getting your house blessed if you have a new house, if you have an old house, anything in between, so as to put on the armor of light and whatever you hold dear. Yes, your car can be possessed. Dolls can be possessed. Quick little anecdote, the Raggedy Ann doll was the basis for Annabelle, was possessed. At least there's historical proof for the like, and it would kill people and the like. So we'll move on to move on to oppression, in which the demon, it's also called vexation, can physically and without possessing you, can physically cause harm to you. It can burn you, it can scratch you, it can harm you, it can move things around. It can do everything which the movies say it can. I guess it'd be a good time to establish what powers demons do and do not have. They do not have anything which is a godlike power. They do not have any access to information which you do not give them in a way. They can only allow you in if you allow them in, I would say. But it is present for a demon. It is present. If you were wondering if a demon is present, if you were a priest giving an exorcism, is that, which I know none of you are not, you're all in college, my freshman Bible study. But is that if they have access to the knowledge to which a person would not normally have, because the the angelic realm, the demons have access to a higher level of knowledge, and things like that. And yes, so I'm going to amend my earlier statement. Yes, if they have, that they will give them knowledge that they wish the person would not have already had. But that's possession later. We'll talk about more power. Yes, more powers later in possession. Yes. I was on oppression slash vexation. Yes, burns, scratches, you know, all sorts of good stuff. Traditionally, the number could be three, as to mock the most holy and blessed Trinity that our triune Godhead exists in. So, like, you know, three scratch. If you three, that's stuck in my throat. If you see three scratch marks, could be a cat, could be a demon. I encourage you to pray about it. If you don't have a cat or a dog, pray about it. Obsession is a way in which the demonic will act against you, as so to, all of your thoughts will be focused some way or another on the demonic. You will be obsessed with the demonic in an unhealthy way. There's a scientific way in which you can study it, and a theological way in which you can have general curiosities in it. But as to so attribute him, too much time and thought, and detracts you from thinking about the glory, justice, and mercy of the divine, is a way in which the devil can attack you. I'll go, before I talk about possession and everything else, I will, this is where I'll put Marcel on the, go a little bit off this basic level of possession and all of these, they're called the extraordinary forms in which the devil can act upon you. I'll say that the devil's greatest way he can act is that in you not believing he exists or you ignoring his existence. I forget this quote as well, but the devil's greatest ability is his anonymity, and that you can be seen fostered in the entire secular world, is that they do not believe he exists or refuse to acknowledge his existence, and then so forth act in a way of sin, and that they cannot be touched by his grasp. Insert the Ouija board and things like that, in which they play around with something they do not believe exists but does exist. The devil will also act in ways in which do not describe your obsession, the things and oppression and things like that. But they act in the way that we sin. They act in the way that we judge others. The demons act in a way that does not bring about the common good, the good of the moral law that God has established. I was watching a video in preparation by Bishop Robert Barron, and he was talking about the different titles they give. They give Satan, you know, the Prince of Lies. I think it was it. And then, you know, how it all exists in lies, because God exists in truth, and he is truth and love. And the devil is the lies against that truth and that love. For example, I told you that quote a few weeks ago, maybe in a month ago now, about St. Basil the Great, who said that the devil cannot make hell beautiful, so he makes the road to get there appealing. And that's a rough quote. But, I say that. I hope this is nothing important. Phone call. Intriguing. Okay, doesn't matter. Anyway, sorry about that. How unprofessional of me to be totally this my parents' home. Also agreed, yes. Because all sin has root in the devil. And that is, of course, one of the major ways in which we acknowledge that he will act, as in through our sin. Because we have chosen the lies of the devil over the fruits and the truth and the love of God. Now, since I'm already approaching 13 minutes and I wish not to delay whatever festivities are taking too long whenever you watch this, if you so choose to watch this, I hope all of you do. I think this is something that's not talked about enough, and that's why I am talking about it. Possession. Yes, a human being can be possessed, in which the devil will exist within them, the devil or demon. Can be Lucifer, can be Beelzebub, can be Legion, can be whatever other demon and devil exists in the fiery place where there is wailing and gnashing of teeth, so-called hell, because hell is a physical, real place. Now, ask me to point it out on a map, though, Alex. What was I going to say? I was going to say, yeah, possession. So it will give the person has the capability of powers that, that a demon can possess, but the human being would not naturally. And so I'll refer to an interview I watched on the Pints with Aquinas podcast YouTube channel with Matt Fred, and an interview he did with Father Vincent Lampert, who is one of the most famous exorcists in the United States. And he talked about that whenever the process now, because there is an International Society of Exorcists, I forget what its official name is, might actually be that, but that the process begins with, they first refer to the person to a psychological person. If there's something that they cannot explain completely by a psychological evaluation, then they move into further steps. And it's something that they would not, the priest usually asks for, to look for, is if they demonstrate knowledge which the person would have in no way knowing. Like, for example, I have no clue, and this might be a little bit of an extreme example, but I would have no clue what any of you are doing right now. I have no reason to know. I have no capability to know what you're doing right now. I have no clue what my mother is doing right now. She's at the gym. But I have no, well, I could possibly reason that she is doing. But I, so say one of you guys. Let's say I have no clue what the heck Chase is doing right now. Not a single clue. But let's say that I were to somehow know, and well, let's say I was being suspected of possession, and I were to somehow know exactly what Chase is doing that exact moment. I have no reason. Let's say I haven't talked to Chase in like a week. I have no reason to conclude. Or there's another example of a priest performing an exorcism, and the possessed person looked the priest in the eye and told him exactly what he had done when he was like 16 and how he had failed with like alcoholism or something like that. The person would have no reason to know exactly that piece of information. Evidence of the demonic. Also speaking in tongues, if there is a language. Let's say this I have no ability to speak Mandarin. I have zero capability of speaking Mandarin. Could I have the virtue of will and choice to learn how to speak Mandarin? Yes, but at this current moment, I have no ability to speak Mandarin. I can speak English, a few phrases in Spanish, and I think I can speak pretty good German. But I have no reason to think that I can speak Mandarin Chinese, and nobody else should. But let's say I start speaking Mandarin Chinese completely and fluently, but then I did not remember as such. That's not the qualifier, per se, that I do not know as much, that I spoke in Mandarin Chinese. But if I start to speak in Mandarin Chinese completely and fluently, talk to me. Talk to a priest. That's an example. Feats of superhuman strength. Superhuman strength. Like if a little 12-year-old girl who is 5'3" and 100 pounds lifts up a car. Sus. By sus, I mean satanic, probably. Unless she just somehow is 100 pounds of pure muscle. What else was I going to say? Yes, of course, there's aversion to the sacred. Many times people will, it could be possibly psychological, but more often, I would say more often than not, but one good sign is that if a person who sees a Bible or crucifix or comes in contact with holy water or anything spiritual starts to go off in spitting and raging fits and starts swearing, even if it's not completely loud, but they start to swear to themselves a little bit, it probably not a great sign. Probably something is going on there. Either way, you should talk to that person and probably talk to a priest, because it either means they simply personally hate the Lord or that they are possessed by a demon who, by their very nature, will hate the Lord. I've told a couple of you guys this story, so I'll tell you guys this story one time more, and I think it's one of my favorite stories about. This is that I also heard this from Father Vincent Lampert, but it also might have been another book, An Exorcist Explains the Demonic by Father Gabriel Amorth. May he rest in peace. He was talking about how there was an experiment, one of the two, both the priests, so I will say he. There's three boxes performing an exorcism. One, they put a miraculous medal of Our Lady, a Saint Benedict medal, and an unconsecrated host in the box. And so the demonic person would have had the person in themselves would not see the things being put in the boxes. But here's this first box with the unconsecrated host. It says, "That is nothing, take it away." And so, unconsecrated host means nothing. It's just a wafer that has the possibility to be transubstantiated. Then it looks at the St. Benedict medal. St. Benedict, and the Benedictine monasteries and things like that. His medal, the Benedictine cross, Benedictine medal, is very well known to be protecting for humans against Satan due to the way he lived his life. But he said, "He scares me. That scares me. I don't like that. I don't like that. Get away from me." Didn't say he likes. I don't like that. I don't like the medal. Get away from me. Because St. Benedict is watching over us in heaven. And then points at the Immaculate, the miraculous medal of our of Our Lady, is get her away from me. She scares me. Notice the language. It doesn't say that or anything like that. It says she. One of the greatest tools we have against the devil is the love for our Blessed Mother, who was, from the beginning of time, will have enmity between her and Satan, and she will squash his head by the power of God, because she was saved free from sin through her Immaculate Conception. And then they do another one, and it's the same two items, but then instead of an unconsecrated host, it's a consecrated host. So you have a consecrated host, Benedict Medal, Miraculous Medal. Benedict Medal, that scares me. No, take it away. They do. She scares me. Get her out of here. And then once again, the person would not have known what's in these boxes, but the demon knows. It says, get him away from me. Why would you bring him near? Why would you bring him close to me, or something like that? And goes off absolutely ballistic, you know. And it shows the real presence of our Lord Jesus Christ in the sacrament of the altar, as well as the power he has over demons. So, okay, I'm already at 20 minutes. Cool story. Possession's real. Pray often. The greatest offense is a recognition of Satan, but the recognition that Christ has a divine power over him and has already won the battle over the demons and sin and death. Now, I'm going to do a quick anecdote about yoga before I talk about probably what most of you here might actually be here for, which is horror movies, my thoughts on those. Yoga. So there's been some debate, more modern debate, about whether it's appropriate for Christians to practice yoga. And until now, like, I don't know, I really don't care. But then I was watching a YouTube video, once again, Pines of Aquinas, I'll put it down below, about yoga. And each one of the yoga positions has to do with some sort of God or spiritual thing in the ideas of Hinduism and Buddhism. And within those is supposed to be some God. But anything which is attributed to false God is most likely something which, if it has been worshipped, is most likely demonic. And so, for example, I forget their names, whatever their names are, probably demons in which the people have been worshiping, which is always good. So if their root is demonic, then I highly discourage any practice thereof, even if you are making that mental, that cognitive idea that you are separating the two from stretching and from trying to do yoga. The recommendation the guy put in there was instead do Pilates. And it's like, well, what if my yoga instructor isn't, you know, teaching me? It might not be the worst. It might not be, you know, full on, but there's still some root in what is most likely the demonic. And so as to, you know, avoid the demonic, which I think we all should, because it can lead to sin and the destruction of our souls, we should avoid it. So if you're looking for a different way to stretch after injury, the guy recommends Pilates, but I will link his video down below because he does a great job of explaining it, because he is a former yogi, which is a practitioner of yoga. But horror movies. Roll Tide. Here I'd like to make a classification, a distinction between horror movies involving the demonic and those that are in, you know, the psychodrama, psychothriller, slasher genre. For the latter, for those, you know, they're just blood, guts, gore, you know, suspense, dramas, whatever, that do not involve the demonic in such an obvious way, is like movies like The Exorcist or something like that. This is strictly me personally talking, that I don't believe that the USCCB puts out movie recommendations for every new movie. Bishops will watch it and then they will give their statements on it. So I think if you just look up USCCB movie reviews, they will give their statements on it, whether they think it is appropriate for a Catholic to watch it as such or at what age. But these are my personal opinions. These are not the bishops. This is not Holy Mother Church. This is not Father Tom. This is not Focus. This is not my parents. This is not anybody else. This is my personal thoughts, which have been influenced by people, but these are my own. If you are watching any like the slasher, you know, psychodrama, I'm like, fair enough. I don't see anything intrinsically wrong with that. I don't see anything that could, I personally just, I'll admit my bias, I just simply hate horror movies in all their forms. And I also just don't personally see the interest in watching blood, guts, gore, whatever. Horror movies, I think, are also distinct from this. That's different. That's speaking to a greater reality. But if you so enjoy those movies, watch them. I would say don't watch them with regularity, because it can distort your view of what humanity is, and that it's not all blood, guts, and gore. There is great beauty in humanity. I don't say it's going to happen to you. I don't think it's going to happen to anybody per se. Well, I would probably say it has. But, you know, don't watch them for regularity. Enjoy the more beautiful things of life more often than you do the blood, guts, and gore. And make it a very distinct difference between how often. Like, if you're going to watch Texas Chainsaw Massacre, as this, if you watch it 1 week, at least for the rest of the week, abstain from watching anything else of such. Or at least for a couple days. Make sure that you pray and recognize the beauty and glory of God. And also try to act in a humane way, because it opens up thoughts that are extraordinarily inhumane. Yeah, that's my thoughts on those sort of movies. But the horror movies. And that's what all of you are here for. Congratulations. If you watched 25 minutes of this, you've finally gotten to what you're here for. I discourage it highly if you were to watch any horror movie which pertains to the demonic. Because the devil will see that you are taking interest in him, and that there are, while they might be like theologically accurate and things like that, I think that anything that which so directly involves the demonic, which is not simply to study him, opens up an uncomfortable barrier that could allow him into your life. The same pertains to Ouija boards. But Ouija boards, I'll take a stronger stance on and say, do not ever touch a Ouija board. If anybody offers you to touch it, to participate in something involving a Ouija board or a seance or a thing, immediately leave the room, pray for their souls, and never talk to them. I wouldn't say never talk to them again. If you ever talk to them again, ask them if they're doing it again, if they're proceeded to do it. Tell them why they are doing wrong. If you'd like to know why they're doing wrong, I will tell you it is because it is a way in which to open up the doors to the demonic. If they don't believe in the demonic, maybe find new friends. Because if they are with you and you are with them and they are practicing these things, they have also, by their fault, opened you up to the demonic. That's what happened in the story behind The Exorcist. Is that it was the aunt who actually played with the Ouija board, and then the demon possessed John Doe, Roland Doe, I think was the name of the movie. Even though I haven't seen it, I've researched it because I find it interesting. I sound like a hypocrite. I don't think so. Regardless, it is not worth putting yourself in unnecessary risk of coming in contact with the demonic and a dramatization thereof. And it like, oh, JP, how do I avoid this? All of my friends want to do it. Well, if all of your friends want to watch a horror movie, and there's nowhere else you can go that would isolate you from yourself, I think it is also very meritorious, Malachi, to, love all of you guys. Whenever something pops up that makes me think of one of you individually, I will mention it so as to let you guys know that I know each one of you individually. Like Michael Moen, you're from St. Louis. The House from The Exorcist is in St. Louis, Missouri. Anyway, in case you didn't know that. It's unnecessary. It's more rare if, like, yeah, so you're a group of friends, and they all want to watch Exorcist of The Exorcist or whatever. Exorcism of whatever. Handle these arrows or whatever. Or they want to watch Annabelle or Tinkerbell. If all of your friends are there and you have no other friends elsewhere that you can go to, stay there. Keep cognizant of what is going on. And I encourage you that either during that time which you're watching the movie, before or after, say the St. Michael prayer. I wish I could have put it there. St. Michael prayer, my dad does. And then ask God and the saints and the angels to keep you safe from the evil one. If you're on a big group of Catholic friends, maybe I suggest that you guys pray together either before or after, so as to protect you from Satan, because in that movie you will probably see the destructive power he can do on the human body as well as the soul. What else? I think that's all I can think of right now. I'd say that you like want to watch a horror movie, like a demonic horror movie periodically, be careful. If you're so compelled to do so with a friend, I would say definitely do not watch them alone. Do not watch them alone, because dangerous things can happen when you're alone, both in a human and in a spiritual sense. So definitely, I would make it a hard line stance, at least on one odd topic. One, just never watch a demonic horror movie alone, because you, I believe in strength in numbers, strength in will, combined will, fraternity. So if your plans tonight were to go and turn on The Exorcist 2 with people, or as I would rather you not do. As for the betterment of your soul, don't do it. Watch anything else. Literally anything else. Watch The Avengers. I don't really care. No, I do care. Because I think, watch something that you would enjoy, but watch something that would be fruitful or bubblegum for the brain. But it would not be to drain. I guess, if you're not familiar with the phrase, bubblegum of the game, maybe that's not what the kids say. Bubblegum for the brain. Something which neither is beneficial, but does not harm you either. Like most things. Yeah. Like Marvel has bubblegum for the brain. Does not make you think, does not make you question higher things, nor think about higher things, nor lower things. Bueno. That being said, hit a like, subscribe. I'm going to put some links in the description for good places to do more research on the topic. People who have different opinions than I do on horror movie, especially when involving the demonic. But that being said, y'all have a safe day, week. Whenever I post this again, I wish you the same. Hopefully you'll have a blessed break and that you may orient yourself towards the good will of God. And pray for y'all. Y'all please pray for me. God bless.